Hello. Hello. Nice name. Welcome back. Hello. Give me just another minute here and we will get started. Alright, let me get switched over here. And there we go. Mic's on. La la la. Yes, it is. Alright. Hello. Hello and welcome to the stream. My name is Alex Azarashi. I'm a Seal Girl VTuber and today is a very special day. Today, we are celebrating my affiliates program acceptance. Jim from TikTok. Hello, hello. Welcome back. Good to see you again. We got two things on the menu today. I'm going to be doing another movie talk. I haven't done one of those in a while. And we're also going to be doing a celebration and I can show you guys all the toggles and all the stuff that I have set up. Let's see. I guess first, I'm just going to talk about what's been going on with me for the past couple days. So thank you. Thank you for the congratulations. I got it like pretty late at night before I was gonna go to bed like 2 days ago and I was so surprised. I'm very, very thankful for every single one of you that decided to come to my stream or even just like have me on in the background. Oh, you got the toggle! Thank you for the cozy time. Yeah, that's one of the toggles I got going on. I have several toggles. Mostly just regarding my avatar. I don't have any like sound toggles or anything like that. Maybe I should put on some background music. Oh, the bonk, it's in the wrong place. Okay, I'll have to fix the bonk. Thank you for the bonk. Do I have any music? Oh, I do have music. Okay, there we go. Yeah, let's keep that on just to have it a little bit interesting. But yeah, I was very surprised. It was not easy. It took me like almost 9 months. 9 months to get here. Because when I started streaming, oh, you have copyright-free music? Oh, that's excellent. I could always use more copyright-free music. I started streaming. Really? The Hyper Light Drifter soundtrack is copyright-free? I didn't know that. I'll look it up later. I'll look it up later. But if it is, that's good. I'll have to write that down. I've never actually played that game before. But what was I saying? Oh yeah, it's taken me like 9 months to get here because when I originally started streaming, I was still living in Japan. And so I was streaming at really like, really dog shit hours. Like I was streaming probably at like, I think midnight to 3 a.m. Pacific time is when I would stream. So, you know, I wasn't really getting anyone in there, but, you know, I learned a lot. I learned a lot of technical stuff, you know, how to use OBS, how to use VTube Studio, all that jazz. And yeah, let's see, what else is going on with me? Oh, that's right. So I got a gym membership, so I can finally go back to the gym. And I went like 3 days ago, but I forgot to stretch beforehand and I went a little bit too hard on the elliptical and now my leg is hurting. It hurts really bad. I mean, it's not hurting as bad as it did before. I want to go back to the gym, but I gotta let it rest a little bit, you know? I need to remember to actually do stretches this time. Because I was just like, I was there and I was so excited. I was like, yes, finally, I get to use the elliptical again. I just like got on there and I'm just like, ah, you know. So that happened. And normally when I have like muscle soreness in my legs, I would take a bath. But I can't do that because we have a problem in our bathroom. There is a leak over the, like, right over the tub. And it's one of those ones where, like, there's a huge bump in the ceiling from the water that's leaking from the pipes above, like, behind, underneath the ceiling. And it looks, it's very large. It looks like it's gonna pop any day now. And so we need to get, like, a plumber in there or some shit. I don't know how they're gonna fix that. It's, like, probably drywall. So we probably have to replace the drywall, and Lord knows how long that's gonna take. So, unfortunately, baths are off the table for me. Yeah, I know. That's what my mom said. That's what my mom told my dad yesterday. And he's like, yeah, don't worry, I'll do it. So, Lord knows when that's gonna happen, because it takes him forever to do anything around here. Let's see. But, yeah. I think let's go into the movie talk. Let's talk about the movies that I've been watching recently. Let's see. What's the first one I have over here? Ah, here we go. Okay. I might turn this down a little bit. I don't know if it's too loud. So this is a Netflix movie. Ah! Sorry. I just knocked my phone off of my desk. It's all good. It's all good. We're fine here. Anyway, so the first movie I'm going to be talking about today is a Netflix movie. It's called Young E. It's a Korean film. It's a science fiction film, as you can probably tell. As probably pretty obvious that it's a science fiction film. Scientific film is different. I'm gonna put up the spoiler warning. Well, I don't want to put it up just yet. When I actually start talking about spoilers, I'll put up the spoiler warning. But I'm gonna talk about my movies first, and then we're gonna go over, like, my toggles and my rewards, and talk about, like, you know, membership and all that stuff. I'm pretty sure I turned off the advertisements for my channel, because I don't want any advertisements. So if there is a chance that Twitch might force advertisements on my channel anyway. I have no idea, like, if they're gonna do that or not, but if they do, I'm going to tell you guys some tips and tricks on how to get around, like, Twitch ads, and, like, talk about Twitch ad block later. So stick around for that. But anyway, back to the movie. So this was a conceptually interesting movie. I liked the ideas that they presented in the movie, although it was still lacking something. It felt like more of a tech demo for, like, the studio than, like, an actual movie with, like, I don't want to say it didn't have substance, but it just, I'll get into it. Let me just explain the basic plot of the movie. So it takes place in the far future, and there's a war going on between Earth and the colonies in space, as is usually the case. And the people of Earth are trying to build a AI super soldier, an AI robot super soldier, I should say. And so they're basically using the brain, the copied brain of this venerated war hero who's really famous, and she did a lot for, like, the war or whatever the fuck. And they basically copied her brain, and they're using it, like, as a basis to make their AI. And so every day they're basically training the AI to overcome obstacles. Specifically, the obstacle that they're training the AI to overcome is the last mission the person it was based off of ever went on when they died. And they basically believe that if they can train the AI to overcome the challenges that the original person it was based on faced, then it will be ready for combat. And so every day they're basically, like, putting this AI robot through, like, kind of, I guess, kind of like a traumatic war zone fight. It's a very cool looking fight. You know, the special effects are very good and all that. But the interesting thing about it is that one of the lead scientists in the project is actually the daughter of the person the robot is based off of. So every day she goes to work and she sees, like, a robot that looks exactly like her mother get basically, like, injured and shot, like, every single day. which is kind of fucked up if you think about it. But she's a very stoic woman. She doesn't let it get to her, and she's very confident that, you know, she's very confident in her abilities and that what she's doing is the right thing. So she doesn't really let it get to her, which is interesting. One thing that the movie goes into is that in this world, there's basically three levels of AI. Like that you can, like you can basically, after you die, have your consciousness put into a robot. Kind of like the whole, like whatever the hell Elon Musk is trying to do. But in this world, there's three levels. So the top level is basically like, you get a cool robot body. And you also get full human rights. And your consciousness is your own. It's not uploaded into a data bank, I don't think. It's not shared with anyone. It's your own. The second one, the second level, that's also the most expensive one, I should say. The second level is slightly less expensive, but your data does get shared with companies, and you have slightly less human rights in that one. Now, the third lowest level is actually what the woman who died, the war hero, that's what her consciousness got uploaded into. And it's basically like, when that happens, you have no human rights. You are essentially, your data, your brain, your memories are all uploaded into, like, I guess kind of like sort of a cloud that companies can like buy and share. They basically like buy and share your data, basically. Like you would actually have a choice, IRL, yeah. And the whole thing is that this third lowest level of like AI consciousness is free, or it's very low cost, which is what a lot of people who want to, like, I guess, live a little bit longer do, although they're not technically human anymore, so I don't know why you would do that. Like, I would rather, if you gave me the choice and said, like, okay, well, you could either die or you could, like, have Google own your brain, I would be like, no, just put me in the ground, dude. Just put me in the ground. Like, no. I don't want to do that. I don't want fucking Google, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook owning like my brain and my memories. Just put me in the fucking ground. I don't want to live forever that badly. Kind of absurd. But anyway, the war hero's data is basically owned by... And anyone can have access to it. Lots of companies can have access to it. So they're basically putting her through these trials and tribulations, and they make a breakthrough. They make some kind of breakthrough in that, like, a neural pathway in her, like, robot brain activates, and they think that they can use that to overcome her, like, final test. So they go to tell the, not the head of the project, but, like, the guy who owns the company, I believe is what he is. And they're like, hey, we made a breakthrough. And he's like, oh yeah, that's cool, but we're shutting down the AI super soldier project and we want to replace it with like a domestic robots project. So you guys are gonna like have to close up soon. And so everyone's pretty upset about that. Especially the woman whose mother is the one that, like, the daughter. She's pretty upset about it too. But one interesting thing happens that kind of like really made me like go, wow. And there's a scene in the movie where she finds out that some like sensitive brain data has been downloaded by someone on her team. And so actually I should put the spoiler warning up. I'll put it up right now. She finds out that the data that was downloaded by someone from her team. And so she goes to confront him. She goes to his room, and he's like a huge, like, huge nerd, a huge fan of her mom. Like, his room is full of like posters and figurines and merchandise of her mom. And that is, I can only imagine like how awkward that must be to find out that one of your coworkers is like idolizes your mom and is kind of like creepily obsessed with her. But it only gets worse from there. So she goes into his room to confront him, and he's like, you know, trying to explain it to her, and she's like kind of walking around, And she goes into the area where his bed is, and she sees a dummy thick sex robot that looks exactly like her mom. So she's like, goes to confront him, and she's like, dude, what the fuck? And he's like, no, I didn't make it. It's the company. They asked me to test it out. So the company has decided to turn her mom into a sex robot that they can sell. And like, that is probably one of the like the strangest things that I have ever seen. And I could only imagine like how incredibly awkward and disturbed like she must have felt in that scene. Like, can you imagine like you find out that like a company is making a sex robot of your dead mother and that your coworker is fucking her? Like, that is that's weird. That's weird, but that happens in the movie. And so she's filled with determination to finish the project because she's like, okay, if I make the super soldier project work, then they won't make sex robots of my mom. So, you know, she goes into that and she kind of like, she sort of does it for a little bit, but then she kind of gives up and she decides like, you know what? I'm just gonna set her free. So within like the robot's control system, you can assign like moderators, I should say, or handlers is probably the better word, who can like turn it off and on and change its behavior and so on and so forth. So she goes into her iPad, she removes all of the handlers from the control system, and she basically tells the robot like, hey, like, I can get you out of here. And the robot becomes sentient, and thus they find out about it, and thus ensues a very long and kind of cool like action fight chase scene. It was probably about like 10 to 20 minutes, but it was pretty good. There was like trains and there was shooting and there's like robots and it's like pew, pew. And I'm not very good at describing action scenes, but it was overall a pretty good action scene. And it basically ends on them taking the train out of the city, and the robot kind of like not confronting, but she's with her daughter, but it's unclear whether she knows that the woman is her daughter or not. They kind of allude to it, but it's never explicitly stated. And the train that they're on stops like outside a forest. And so the woman convinces her like mother to just be free. It's the only way you're gonna be free. So the movie ends on her jumping and escaping into the forest while her daughter is in the train and dying. But yeah, I would give it probably like a 7 out of 10. It was a very nice movie. You know, like I said, it felt like more of like a tech demo for like the special effects departments. It had some very interesting concepts, like I talked about, the whole like AI thing, having your consciousness uploaded. But it didn't really like expand on it in a way that was meaningful. So I can't really give it full points for that. But if you're looking for like a short, kind of like interesting action film about like robots, it takes place in the future and cool and stuff, I'd recommend it. It's on Netflix film. Don't know if it's available in other parts of the world on Netflix, but you know, sure, you could find a way to look for it if you try. All right, let's go to the next movie here. Let's see, what do I got next? Okay, I know what I can talk about. I'll load this one up. So I also watched Gundam Hathaway. So I had actually, as some of you may know, I am a Gundam enjoyer, UC Gundam specifically. Haven't really seen any of the other ones, although I have seen Witch from Mercury. But I put off this movie for quite a while, and I finally watched it the other day. So immediately, I was filled with the warm and fuzzy feeling that I usually get when I watch something UC Gundam. I don't know why, but it's just very like, I don't know. I just like it. I just like it. It makes me happy. And it's very similar to Char's counterattack in a way. It takes place in the timeline after Char's counterattack, about, I think it was like 20 something years after Char's counterattack. So basically it's about Noah Hathaway, who is Bright Noah's son, who is also featured in Char's Rebellion. And it's basically about him. And the movie was a little bit, it wasn't bad, but it didn't really feel like there was, it was complete in a way. Basically, I'm gonna put the spoiler warning on again, because I don't really have a whole lot to say about this movie, but what I'm gonna say is probably gonna be spoilers. Basically, Noah is the new Char clone in this world. They basically just like straight out say like, oh hey, this guy is like the new Char or whatever. But basically, Noah is the leader of the new like insurgency, I should say. But he's like, he's not openly the leader. He's like the secret leader. So he's like using his kind of like status as the son of Bright Noah to kind of schmooze around, but in secret he's actually God, I forgot his name. He has this like alter ego name that's like really kind of, it's a Gundam name. It's kind of stupid. Let me look it up real quick. I mean, if you know Gundam names, then you know it's weird. What does it say? Mafdi Nalv Aaron, a very Gundam name, who is basically trying to get the Earth, get everyone on Earth to leave into space, kind of like how Char did, but without like sending a meteor right into Earth. He kind of does it through like, well, people more or less say he's a terrorist, which is kind of objectively true, but you know, it's the usual, the Earth forces are being big and mean, and they're being mean to people, and so the rebellion is trying to get the Earth people to rise up against their oppressors, blah blah blah, usual Gundam. He's the new Char clone, and he's got, there's a moment in the film where he has Riz. There's the woman you can see in the film with the long blonde hair. He kind of rizzes her, but then he like has sort of second thoughts and kind of becomes an incel. Oh shit, I'm not allowed to say that word. Fuck. Okay, anyway, just pretend I didn't say that. He kind of becomes like involuntary. Well, no, actually it is voluntary. He becomes voluntarily celibate and decides to focus his efforts on like, you know, being the leader of the organization or whatever. The one thing I thought was interesting about this movie is that there's an actual Jollibee tie-in, which made me laugh. Like, seeing him and his buddies eat at Jollibee, like, that got a chuckle out of me. That got a chuckle out of me. It's supposed to take place in, like, a Southeast Asian country. I'm assuming, I don't know if it was a real place or not. Gundam likes to use fake places based off of real places, so probably the Philippines. We'll say he was somewhere in the Philippines, why don't we? And it was like, so the final battle, the big battle, which I'm just going to like talk about because that is pretty much like the most, what it should be the most important thing when it comes to like a Gundam episode or a Gundam movie. The final battle was very disappointing. It took place entirely at night, meaning that like you could not see the details on the robots very well. Like they didn't even have the light up thing. Like for example, in Unicorn Gundam, which most of the fights, actually no, I think all of the fights take place in space. They have, you know, like glowing effects on the robots. They have like, you know, parts of them that light up, or they have like, you know, like the light from the sun shining on them or the light from another source. But this one, the lighting on the final battle was extremely flat. I could not see the details on the robots, which was very disappointing, because they looked like, some of them looked cool and I wanted to see them, but they didn't even have any, it was just flat, very flat lighting, and ultimately I was quite disappointed in it. I don't even know, they probably sell kits based on the robots, but like, come on, like if you're gonna show off the robots, then show them off, make them look good, make them look cool. They failed to do that in this, which was very disappointing. But I mean, the animation was very good. You know, it was very smooth. It looked good. It kind of has like that sort of UC style, which I like. A little bit more detail, not exactly the same, but it was nice. All in all, I would say it was definitely a McDonald's movie, which I mean, to be fair, most Gundam kind of is a McDonald's series. And I use that phrase a lot when I say McDonald's, when I mean it's like, it's style, but it's not really a lot of substance. Like, it's there to make you buy the toys. And I understand that, and I still like it. But otherwise, I would say that this is like a visually a very good looking movie, but substance wise, it's just like, it didn't hit it for me. I would say, I want to give it a 6 because it's Gundam and I like Gundam, but like I said, that final battle was just so visually disappointing that I really can't give it more than a 6. Yeah, that's my review of Gundam Hathaway. Let's move on to the next one, shall we? Let me turn off the spoilers real fast. And what do I have next? Oh yes, the next one I'm very excited to talk about. Okay, this is gonna be a little bit controversial, I think. Yes, here we go. So I watched the Street Fighter movie. Very topical too. I watched the Street Fighter movie from 1994. This movie is based on a little indie game you might have heard of called Street Fighter 2. By the band Capcom. And I know this movie, like, people give it a lot of shit. People give video game movies a lot of shit, and I understand why. But I liked it. I thought it was a fun movie, and that's how I feel about most video game movies. Because, like, to be honest, most video game movies I don't really have, like, an emotional investment in, because I've never played the games. Like, I never played the only Resident Evil game I played is Resident Evil 8. I've never played any of the other ones, but I've seen the movies. I've seen the Doom movies as well, but I've never played Doom, and I thought they were fun. What other movie did I watch? I have yet to watch the Tekken movie. I need to watch that. That's on my list. But the Street Fighter movie, it was a silly movie. It was a fun movie. Very misleading, because there's only one instance of actual street fighting in this movie. Everything else kind of takes place in the jungle or in like other places. So very misleading title. I don't know that much about Street Fighter lore, so I could be getting like, I have no idea if it's lore accurate or not. So if I get something wrong, I apologize. It takes place in what appears to be a knockoff Cambodia called Shadaloo. I don't know if that's a real place in the Street Fighter universe, but it is in the movie. And, you know, it's about M. Bison being M. Bison, the evil overlord that he is trying to take over the world. Played by Raul Julia, who does a very good job at portraying M. Bison, I think, as a very, like, evil overlord. Definitely more effective than Dr. Evil, but I would say they kind of have the same sort of vibe going on. Only, like I said, M. Bison is more is more competent than Dr. Evil. The costume design was very good. They actually, like, credited the costume designer for M. Bison's costume in the beginning of the movie. I don't have who it is on, like, with me right now, but they did an excellent job, because his costume is absolutely, it's gorgeous, it's very well made, it fits well, I guess it looks like M. Bison, you know, but I think it's good, and I think his performance was good too. It also stars Jean-Claude Van Damme as Guile. And I have never seen a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie. I know that he's like an action star from like, what, the 80s and the 90s? But he's a good looking guy. Like, I didn't know that he was hot. Like, he's a good looking guy. You know what it is? It's the beret. It's the Spec Ops beret. That's what really does it for me. I like the Spec Ops beret. That without the beret, he's kind of like meh, but with the beret, I'm like, oh, okay. So this is definitely not the highest budget movie. There's one scene in particular that made me laugh, and it's a scene where they're kind of uncovering who the bad guys in the gang are. There's like a gang that's associated with like M. Bison or whatever, and they all have these tattoos. And normally in movies, they use like a specific type of temporary tattoo that doesn't come off very easily. But in this movie, the tattoos were very clearly drawn on with some kind of marker. Like, they're only on screen for maybe a few seconds, but they were very obviously drawn on marker to me, which made me laugh. Like, come on, you could have put just a little bit of the budget into the fake tattoos, right? But anyway, another casting choice that I thought was interesting was Kylie Minogue as Cammy. Kylie Minogue of that Can't Get You Out of My Head fame, which she did a good job as Cammy, I think. You know, she's a good looking woman. She's got it, you know? The fights were all, you know, choreographed action fights from the 90s. Pretty standard stuff. I don't really have anything in particular to say about them. But another person who was down bad with it was Zangief in this movie. Like, I had to look up the actor afterwards because I thought he was, like, really good looking. And he's, like, a bodybuilder. But there's, like, damn, three people in this movie that are like really down bad with it, and I was like, okay, you know, we got Jean-Claude Van Damme, we've got Kylie Minogue, and we've got Zangief. I was like, okay, I like this movie. I like this movie. Let's see, I'm looking at my notes right here, and I wrote down, I like how Bison, with all his state-of-the-art military technology, still has rusty, easily broken chains in his torture chambers. Like, there's a scene where they take Honda and the boxer, whose name I forget, into like the torture chamber, and they escape because it's a really bad looking torture chamber. It's like they got all their supplies from like the Halloween store, and they just like covered it with some like paint. Very low budget. But it's so funny to me how it's like Bison is like bragging about his like state-of-the-art military technology, and then his torture chambers just have these like rusty chains that they break super easily. Oh. This movie does feature Blanca, who is probably like the worst looking in terms of like the special effects and the makeup. They're just bad. They just look really bad. Like, you can Google Blanca Street Fighter movie, and it's not good. It's like, if you've seen the Mortal Kombat movie from the 90s, it's like the same level. I did like the Mortal Kombat movie though, from the 90s. I watched that one and I thought it was a fun movie. I have to admit, that's probably a controversial thing, because it was a fun movie. It was a fun movie. It was a silly movie. It was a fun movie. But that's neither here nor there. In terms of like, which is better, I think the Mortal Kombat movie from the 90s is more entertaining than this one, but this one has hotter people in it, so I'm gonna have to give the Street Fighter movie a little bit of a higher rating than the Mortal Kombat movie. I'd give it probably a 6 out of 10. It was entertaining, it was silly, it was fun, you know? a bit of a controversial statement, but it's just a fun movie. If you're thinking about it, like, ooh, this is not about Street Fighter, this is bad because they get this wrong and this is not lore accurate, then it's like you're not gonna enjoy it. But if you just think of it like a fun little, you know, action romp from the 90s, then you'll probably enjoy it, right? that's my feeling about it anyway. Let's see. I don't really have any spoilers for this movie because the plot is kind of like the plot is kind of Ned. It's like M. Bison is trying to take over the world. Guile and his crew defeat M. Bison. The end. That's the plot of the movie. Not really much to see there. Let's see. What else do I have here? Oh yes, I have one more. Do I have two more movies? I have two more movies to talk about. Then we're gonna move on to the celebration. So, poster. I'm going to switch this to a movie I watched last night. And as some of you may know, I have been watching the the Evil Bong movies. This is the third movie of the Evil Bong series that I watched. And they get sillier. They get simultaneously better and worse with each movie. I'm not sure why I like these movies so much when they're so clearly, like, stupid and bad, but, like, I don't know, I just enjoy them. Like, I never enjoyed B-movies before watching these movies. And I think they're just, like, silly. I just like silly movies. I like silliness. So, let's get into the plot. So, it stars the same characters, different cast, same characters from the previous movies. So we have the nerd Alistair, who is on the center of this photo. You have Larnell, who I only remember the names of like two characters, but basically you have this like kung fu guy on the right, and you have this normal looking dude on the left, and these people down here, I'll explain. So basically, our straight-laced hero, Alistair, the guy in the middle, who, by the way, is recast for the third time in this series. Like, it's funny to me because they recast him each time with, like, a slightly, very slightly better-looking actor each time. So, like, the first time, like, in the first movie, he was, like, really super nerdy-looking, super, like, stereotypical, kind of, like, weak, skinny nerd guy. The second movie, they had, like, a more attractive guy, but they nerded him up, right? They gave him the glasses, they gave him the dorky haircut, but he was still kind of like good looking. In this one, it's like another, like, I guess conventionally attractive looking guy, but they nerd him up, you know, they part his hair down the middle, they give him the glasses, they give him like the little button up and the tucked in pants. They do what they can to make him look as like dorky as possible. So a meteor falls to Earth, and some random guy finds it, and he brings it to a head shop that's owned by Bachman, who's like, he's like the surfer dude, he talks like this. He's the guy on the bottom right of the poster who is like in a pile of what appears to be plant matter, shall we call it? And Larnell, who's the guy on the right side of the poster, who I think also got recast again. But Alistair finds the remains of the meteor, and he's convinced by the kung fu guy that it's actually a spaceship. And they're trying to figure out what's the deal with it. So they go to talk to their buddies at the head shop, and it's been like several years since they've last seen each other. Because in the last movie, they went to like Brazil to defeat like the other Evil Bong in Brazil. So they haven't seen each other in a while. And so they discover that the guy who found the Space Bong, which as you can see is right in the middle of the poster, it's a bong from outer space. Brings it to the head shop and sells it to them for $20. And so they all come in there and they're like, oh, whoa, it's another weird bong. And, you know, one of them smokes out of it, is transported to the bong world. which it's an alien bong world with alien strippers. You know, it's the same in every movie. There's just women with their honkers out and they're trying to be sexy and all that shit, but this time they're covered in like this really cheap looking body paint that's like glow in the dark. So there's that. Oh yes, let me try to read the quote I wrote down in Bachman's voice. Looks like some kind of space bong. So the guys realize that they are once again in the midst of an evil bong that they must defeat in order to save their friends. And specifically, they find out that this evil bong is trying to, like, basically steal... Well, it's like... How do I explain this? It's basically, like, trying to take over the world with, like, its space weed or whatever. But they all, you know, they go into the bong world and they're seduced by the alien strippers. And they're hooked up to these machines that harvest their, how do I say this? The alien bong is using them to harvest their seed. Yes, that is the plot of the movie. So they have to go in there and they have to stop the evil bong from harvesting their material, and they defeat it by, well, how do they defeat it? I don't even know. I was watching the movie and I was paying attention, but I don't understand how they defeated it. Like, the kung fu guy did like his like ninja shit on all like the alien women and made them pass out, and then the evil bong is like, no, and then they're saved. I don't even remember. It was so like inconsequential that it's like not even important how they defeated the bong. But you know, that's what was going on in the bong dimension, and they did what they usually do and they defeated it. This also featured the evil bong from the first movie, which they brought into the bong dimension with them. So you had a bong inside the bong dimension that sort of helped them defeat it. Specifically, there's a line that I thought was very funny that got me a laugh out of me that the original evil bong said. The original evil bong said, his meat flute ain't playing no more tunes. And I just I thought that that was such a good line. I had to mention it. But yeah, not a whole lot going on in the evil bong movies. Why are my eyes... Hello? Okay, it's working now. Sorry, my eyes are... Okay. Sorry, my eyes keep closing for some reason. Anyway, it was a fun movie. It was a silly movie. It's evil bong. You know, don't go into it and expecting that much. I'd give this one maybe like a 4.5 out of 10. That's what I rate it. I wouldn't say it's like particularly better or worse than the other ones. But yeah, that's pretty much what's going on in the evil bong universe. I don't know what the next one has in store for me. Probably more of the same. Oh no, his poor flute. Yeah, but they get saved, and I think they're intact. They remain intact. I hope that's what happens. So the last movie I'm going to be talking about today, I was probably the best one I've seen in a long time, and I'm very excited to talk about it. So let me go and switch this over here. I could not find a good poster for this movie. I don't know why. I can only find like a 200 pixel poster, so it's gonna be looking really blurry. This is a movie. Let me get my notes out because I got a lot to say about this. This is a British movie. It's a horror movie. I think it's an indie film. It said that it was in production with like the British Film Institute or something. So it could have been someone's like student film movie. My eyes. What the hell? Okay, VTube Studio is being weird. My eyes keep closing. Let me check something real quick. Okay, I think we're good. Okay, sorry about that. Anyway, so this is a British film. It's a very British film. In fact, I had to use subtitles for it because they speak in a very British way that is difficult for me to understand. And I'm usually pretty good with accents, but this is one that I had to use the subtitles for. It's a horror film. The plot is basically like a disgraced puppeteer is returning to his hometown for some reason. Do I have to take my glasses off? My model, the eyes on my model keep closing. Like when I look over at my screen, my eyes are closed. Okay, if it happens again, just like let me know. Anyway, so the aesthetic is a very dark in kind of, it's very dark, it's very tense, and it's a very oppressive feeling movie. Like you watch it and you are just, hold on. Okay, I think someone just came back. You are really, it's a very oppressive feeling. You watch it and you feel the tension. You feel like these dark and heavy, like, weight on you. The way the movie makes you feel. It's also, like, very specifically British looking, if that makes sense. Like, if you've ever watched, like, a British television show, like a British crime murder drama, it has a lot of the same, like the way they film it, the shots that they have, the way the shots linger. It's a very specific kind of thing that I've noticed a lot of British media does. It's also very like very dry feeling, which I suppose like is what most British things are like. Hold on, let me check the door real fast. I need to check something. Okay, emergency. My dog just threw up on the carpet, so I need to clean this up. I'm gonna put us on BRB. Shit. Okay, sorry guys. Give me a few minutes. I need to figure this out. Okay. All right. I cleaned it up to the best of my ability. I threw some hot water on it. Just gotta let it soak for a little bit, and then I'll see what I can do. Oh boy, I don't know what happened. Like, I heard a weird noise earlier, so I paused and I went outside, and everything was fine. And then, like, I just look into the living room, and then I see all this yerk all over the carpet. Like, at first I thought it was, like, diarrhea. But then upon closer inspection, I realized it was like throw up. So I cleaned it up to the best of my ability. My mom's probably gonna get pissed when she gets back. So I might have to cut the stream a little bit shorter so I can get that properly cleaned up. But I don't know what happened. She seems fine. She's not like freaking out or anything. But yeah, I don't know what happened. Let me get switched back over here. Oh boy, that was quite a scare. All right, not much I can do about it though. So let's see, where was I? I was talking about this movie. I believe I was saying it's very British. That's what I remember I was saying. Very specific aesthetic. One thing that I liked about this movie is it's about a puppet. As you can probably tell by the poster, it's an extremely looking arachnid type puppet. And one thing the movie does that I like is that it very slowly visually introduces you to this puppet. It doesn't like force it in your face right away. It starts off with you see like maybe just the tip of a leg in one scene. You see a little bit more of it in the next scene. And it very slowly visually shows you bits and pieces of it. It's not until about, I would say, halfway through the movie where you actually see like the full body of the puppet. And it's a pretty freaky looking puppet. Like, it's very disturbing looking. I will say that. It's not a nice looking puppet. Puppets in general are pretty creepy looking, but this one is very, very creepy, very disturbing. And more or less the plot is that the puppeteer who created this puppet, he keeps trying to destroy it. He keeps like, at first he like beats it up and he like kicks it to the side and then it comes back to him. What happens is he tries to get rid of the puppet each day, and each day either the puppet somehow makes its way back to him or he freaks out and he goes to find it again. Like, there's a scene where he clearly wants to get rid of it. There's a scene where he's at like a river and he has it in his bag and he throws it into the river. And after he does that, he has a kind of like breakdown. Like, he falls down and he starts like having some kind of like mental breakdown. And then he runs down to the riverbank and he goes looking for it. He's like searching everywhere for it and he's freaking out because he can't find it. And then he finds it a little bit later, like covered in mud, up on the shore. And he seems so relieved when he does find it. It's very interesting because even though he's like consistently trying to get rid of it, whenever it comes back to him or whenever he finds it, he's simultaneously relieved and horrified. Like, he even goes as far as to burn it. And when it comes back to him, at first he's scared, but he kind of comes to accept it. And without like getting too much into the plot, because this is a very good movie and I don't want to spoil it because I think people should watch it, it becomes very apparent that the puppet is a manifestation of childhood trauma. He talks specifically about a few incidents that happened in his childhood that were ultimately very disturbing, but it becomes very clear that the puppet is a representation of some kind of like repressed trauma that he has. And it continuously follows him around. It even goes as far, like probably like one of the freakiest scene in the movie is a scene where he allows the puppet to chase him around town. Like, we never, for most of the movie, we never see the puppet move. It's implied that it moves, that it has changed positions, but we don't see it move until the, towards the end of the movie. And it is so, so creepy. It is, it's just, oh God, it makes my skin crawl. Like, don't look it up. I would say watch the movie for yourself, because it's definitely a good movie. Very creepy, very atmospheric, made my skin crawl. And probably one of the best horror movies I've seen in quite a while. I really do like movies that are very atmospheric and very creepy. And this movie really hit the nail on the head for me. It really did what I wanted it to in terms of like what I think a horror movie should do. And just keep you on edge. And the locations that they filmed this movie in are also very creepy. It takes place in a very like kind of drab British town, which I suppose in and of itself is kind of scary. You know, being trapped in like a tiny little British town. But very, very good movie. I do have a bit of a warning though. There is a somewhat graphic assault at the end of the movie. I won't get too much into it. It's not like so, it's more like implied than it is like visual. I mean, there is some like visual violence, but it's definitely implied that a much worse thing happens or is a potential to happen. So if that's something that, you know, you are don't really want to see, then I would say keep that in mind. But it's only at the very end of the movie, and it really does not last a very long time. It definitely like surprised me. I was not expecting it. It kind of came out of nowhere, but I suppose like with the way the movie was going, I kind of should have expected something like weird like that to happen. So, you know, just a little warning. But overall, I would give this movie like an 8 out of 10. Very, very creepy, very atmospheric. Just a really good movie. I highly recommend it. I believe I saw this on Amazon. It might be on Netflix. It might be on another streaming source. It's a British movie, so I would imagine they probably like have it available in like Europe as well. But I would highly recommend this movie. Very, very good movie. Very excellent movie. Very creepy. Probably one of the best I've seen in a long time. But yeah, that's gonna be it for my movie talk today. Let me move myself over a little bit so I can show you guys the toggles. And get rid of the desk. I'll get rid of the chair too. And let me move myself. Yeah, I'll move myself over here so you guys can see. So, yeah, let's get into the meat and potatoes of it. So, I am not partner. Fuck. I've already forgotten. Anyway, I have monetization on Twitch now. And I wanted to say thank you. Thank you to all of you who come to my streams. Thank you to those of you who watch my VODs. You know, even if you just lurk, I'm thankful. Even if you have me on in the background while you do something else, I'm thankful. Even if you have me muted in the background while you watch another streamer, I'm thankful, because at the end of the day, you taking the time to put me on, or you just finding my content interesting and liking the sound of my voice or what I do, I'm thankful for it. I really am grateful. And really, like, no, I really don't expect people to, like, you know, subscribe or do bits or anything like that. Like, there's no pressure to do so. You know, if you just want to follow me for free, that's totally fine with it. I'm okay with it, because at the end of the day, the best way to support me is to just watch my streams, you know, have me on in the background. That's really, you know, what I'm here for and what I'm thankful for. But I do, if you want to interact with me some more, I do want to show you guys some of the interactables with the channel points I have, my seal snacks, I should say. As you can see, this redeem is called Cozy Mode, Cozy Time, I should say. And I want to make it so that it'll go away after a certain period of time, but I'm not entirely sure how to do that. So I'll just clear it out in VTube Studio so I can show you guys the other ones. So let's go. So first of all, I have a head pat. There we go. Yay, head pat. Just a cute little thing. Someone recommended I have one, so I decided to have one in there. Creeper Nando, hi, how's it going? Glad you stopped by. Thank you. I'm just showing off my redeems now. So that one was the head pat. What else do we have here? We have the usual Twitch stuff, highlight my message. Someone redeemed Bonk earlier. Let me show you guys Bonk. Hopefully it'll work this time. Okay, I don't know why. Oh, I know why it's like that. Okay, I'll have to fix that later. It's supposed to bonk me in the head, but I messed it up, so it's not bonking me in the head, but I will fix it later. Let me show you what else I got here. We have Pope mode. Yes, there we go. This is the Pope hat I made for my Dark Souls 3 streams. Let me show you guys the full details here. Yeah, there we go. that's my Pope hat. Made it myself. Let's see, that's one of the other ones I have there. Let me clear out this one so we can go to the next one. What else do we got? We also have egg on my face. Does that mean there's a steel deacon somewhere? I would like to think so, yes. I'd like to think so. Steel Souls 3. Yeah, true. This one, I like the egg. I thought the egg was cute. What else do I got here? Oh yeah, you can turn my jacket, put my jacket on or off. There we go. You know, just in case I get too warm, I get too cold, you can put my jacket on or take it off. What else we got here? Unlock a random sub emote, choose an emote to modify. Oh yes, I should show you guys the emotes as well. You like the jacket? Oh, thank you. I did add emotes to my stream. Most of them are free. These are the ones that I made a few weeks ago over on I think my Kick streams. So let me put the emotes in chat so you guys can see them. Let's see. Seal angry. How do they look when they come up on the screen? Let me take a look here. Not coming up. Oh, wait, no. Hold on. Let me try it. Let me try it this way. I might have it set so that the emotes... Oh, there it is. Okay, now it's coming up. So that's the clapping emote. Because, you know, seals, we like to slap, we like to clap. What else we got here? Got the Angi. We have Sag. We got Squishy Face. I think these are all the... These are, I think, the tier 1 emotes. I think these are the tier 1 emotes. So let me see... Channel emotes, Twitch... Oh, you know what? I had some more, but I don't know if they were approved by Twitch yet. Because I know some of them needed to be approved before they could be used. So I'm not entirely sure if they... Channel emotes. Let's see here. Yeah, it's not showing my emotes. Oh, maybe this is it. No, it's not showing all my emotes. Okay, that's odd. Well, if you guys are able to, the free emotes should be there. Okay, I guess they didn't get approved yet, but I have a few other emotes that, you know, will hopefully be approved within the next few days. So hopefully that'll go through. But, what else did I want to talk about? Oh yes, so I want to talk about the ads thing. So I turned off ads on my videos. I turned off the pre-rolls, and I'm pretty sure I turned off the mid-rolls as well. So you should not be seeing any ads on my videos. I don't want ads. I don't care about the 5 or 3 cents I'd get from an advertisement. I don't like ads. I know you guys don't like ads, so we're not doing any advertisements on here. But if you do have an advertisement, if you do see one on my channel, I am going to share with you some ways to get around them. So I have a list here of like ad blockers and stuff that are you should be able to use with Twitch. Right now on this computer, I am using uBlock Origin and AdBlocker Ultimate, as well as a VPN. And I have not been getting any advertisements on this computer. However, on my other computer, this is on Firefox too, I should mention. I'm using Firefox. And I haven't been getting any advertisements on this computer. On my other computer, however, I do use like the same stuff, but I still get ads. So I don't know what the difference is. But I do have some tips and tricks that I've gathered from around the internet. So I've heard that if you use a VPN, setting it to Poland or certain Baltic countries can get you around the ads, because they don't run ads in Twitch in those countries. I have not tried it out myself, but it's worth a try if you use a VPN and you really want to get around those ads. It's worth a try. Let's see, uBlock Origin. uBlock sometimes works. Like I said, I'm using it right now. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So it's really a hit or a miss. There's another extension for Chrome. I haven't tried it. It's called Twitch AdBlock Plus. I have not used it. I've heard people say that it works. I've heard some people say that it doesn't work. So I'd recommend trying it if you use Chrome. I don't know why you'd use Chrome, but if you do use Chrome, it's worth a try. What else? A Firefox extension that I have used is called Alternate Player for Twitch. And this one I think you can get off of the Firefox extension store. It does skip the ads on Twitch. The only problem is that sometimes it doesn't work if you want to follow or subscribe to someone. So that's just one thing to watch out for. But Twitch Alternate Player for Twitch for Firefox, that's an extension you could try if you want to get around the ads. Another one that I have heard of yesterday is an extension for Chrome and Firefox called ttv.lol. I have not used it, but I have heard that it works according to the good peoples of Reddit. Some people say that it works. So it's worth a try if you want to try that ad block thing. Also, another extension, like just in general, that I would recommend for Twitch is also an auto points redemption one. Because I know Alternate Player for Twitch on Firefox has an auto point redemption. So I would recommend doing an auto point redemption too if you want to collect your points and you want to interact with me on stream. But yeah, you know, I'm, like I said before, I'm happy that you guys have, you know, chosen to watch me. I'm happy that you guys take time out of your day, even if you just have me on in the background. I'm thankful for it. Yeah, I don't know, should I keep the egg on or should I take it off? I'm not so sure. But let's see, I do have a sub goal, as you can see. I have five, I decided to set it for 5, something small, right? And I was actually very surprised that I got my first sub like not too long after I posted the goal. So ZanettiFan_4, if you're here, thank you so much for being my first ever subscriber. I really appreciate it. I've also added a few people, VIPs, some of the OGs. Let's see, anyone else I gotta say thanks to? Oh yes, the people of the forum. The forum. I'd like to thank the people of the forum. If you know, you know. If you don't worry about it. Thank you guys so much. Oh, thank you to Murray Shinaide. Thank you for posting me, and thank you for, you know, checking in on my streams. I really appreciate it. You guys are welcome here, so long as you don't say anything that can get me in trouble. But yeah, I mean, honestly, this is one of the goals that I set for myself for this year. And I'm happy that I was able to achieve, you know, at least one thing. you know, like I said, I've been searching for a job. Hasn't been going so well. So I've been a little down lately, just because I'm kind of in a period of waiting right now. I'm waiting to hear back from a school that I applied to. I'm waiting to hear back from jobs. So I'm happy that I at least have one thing, one thing that I was able to achieve within the past few months. So once again, thank you guys. Thank you so much. I'm gonna check on my dog again real quick. So I'll be right back. I just wanna make sure she's okay. Okay, I'm back. The dogs are okay. The dogs are okay, thankfully. Gosh, I'm probably gonna have to clean that up again. So I think what I might do, you have a loving community, which is not easy to get, even if we're very little, we enjoy the streams. Yeah, thank you. I'm super thankful to everyone who comes to the stream, to everyone who watches my VODs. I really am. It makes me really happy. But let's see. I think what I might do, I do have to take the dogs out. Berserker of Oban, hi, welcome, welcome. I'm wondering if I should just end the stream here and then take them out, clean it up, and then start another stream afterwards. Because I'm feeling like if my mom comes home and she sees like the dog throw up all over the carpet, she's gonna be pissed. So I need to actually clean that up. So I think what I'm gonna do is I'm going to call it for right now. And then in a few hours, probably maybe like an hour or so. Let me see what time it is. Okay, in a few hours, I'm probably going to stream again once I get this shit all figured out. So, you know, hopefully we'll get more people in. I realize that starting my stream so early in the day probably isn't such a good idea because no one likes it when I don't get a lot of people when I stream out like, you know, 4 o'clock. It's usually nighttime when people start coming in. So I'm going to call it for right now, and then in an hour or two, I'm going to stream again. Yeah, thank you so guys. Can't speak. Thank you guys for coming. I really appreciate it. Hopefully I will see you again in like an hour or so. And yeah, that's gonna do it for me right now. Rosie Rose, hi, welcome. Okay, I'll see you guys in a little bit. Bye bye.